Order! Order! You are an incorrigible delinquent at times. Behave yourself, man!
Tasty. Like me, that fruity mayor of London, Boris Bogo Johnson, found himself in a bit of a jam this week. When Bogo wasn't likening the European single market to making marmalade, he was distancing himself from a sticky memo from an aide banning City Hall staff from disagreeing with a boss on Europe. Only 24 hours earlier, Bogo had accused pro-EU campaigners of gagging opponents. I think I've made a bit of a cock-up with this. Yes, it's a cock-up. Perfectly accept that. It's not something that I agree with. And my staff, my team, have complete freedom to say what they want. Indeed, they already are and have been for some days. Let 100 flowers bloom, folks, okay? Right, let's start again. Bogo sweetly quoting Chairman Mao is a taste of the bitter polarisation ahead of June's referendum, with Leavers roasting Bank of England Governor Mark Carney for raising unappetising risks if Britain leaves Europe. Oh, God! Ow!
The issue is... The biggest domestic risk to financial stability.
This is what I think is doing your reputation and the reputation of the Bank of England harm. You are coming out with the standard statements of the pro-EU group. It is speculative and beneath the dignity of the Bank of England to be making speculative pro-EU comments.
I'm not going to let that stand.
Carney blew a raspberry back. But a far juicier public figure of much greater magnificence also objected to being accused of taking sides. The Majer's royal warrants appear on some inferior preserves, but the monarchical damson in distress was not amused when the Sun screamed, "Queen backs Brexit," based supposedly on a conversation at a Windsor Castle luncheon in 2011. Buckhouse complained to the press regulator Ipso, and the argument over Britain in or out of Europe is getting wonderfully messy.
But I think it's appalling that the people who want to pull the United Kingdom, to drag the United Kingdom out of the European Union, are now trying to drag the Queen into the European referendum debate. As for the story in the Sun, it's nonsense. It's not true. I couldn't be clearer than that.
The right royal row in Britain followed a European Union deal to pay Turkey a king's ransom to stem the flow of refugees and economic migrants. In turn, keeping mum about the new sultan in Ankara, crushing dissent, and seizing control of the country's largest newspaper. David Cameron and Jeremy Corbyn's bouts are rarely tasty, producing little heat and shedding even less light. And this week's was no different.
If we really do have the strong economy that the Prime Minister claims, then why did the Chancellor warn last week, I quote, "We may need to make further reductions." Who will these reductions fall on? The disabled, pensioners, young people, women? Is he going to rule out attacking those groups?
Prime Minister?
Well, he will see the budget next week when my right honourable friend the Chancellor, who has an excellent record of steering this nation's economy, will stand up to give that.
With George Osborne bottling the big pension reform that would have been a single rate of tax relief benefiting all workers, the Chancellor's in a sticky position of his own, and needs a new recipe in next week's budget to revive his jarring political fortunes. And it was supermarket baskets at dawn when the Scots Nats joined Labour MPs and Tory rebels to oppose government plans to let supermarkets open all hours on Sundays in England and Wales. Ooh, whiskey.
I and my SNP colleagues are not prepared to gamble with the pay packets of some of Scotland and the UK's lowest paid workers.
Why is it that in this country, this government thinks that we should put the free market above everything else?
The ayes to the right, 317. The noes to the left, 286.
So it's jam today, jam tomorrow, and jam between 11 and 5 on Sundays. Ooh, I see we've made marmalade. Your lady mama.
Kevin Maguire there making a mess at the London Jam Factory. Michael, do you believe the Sun story that says Her Majesty backs Brexit?
No, absolutely not. Her Majesty has not given a political opinion in 90 years, and I don't think that suddenly her resolve broke down at this compelling lunch with Nick Clegg and Michael Gove.
Do you?
I'm just delighted that this week it's the Queen that we're speculating because she's actually alive. And before it's been Churchill, Thatcher, the suffragettes Priti Patel brought on. I'm just delighted it's not just dead people we care about how they might have voted in the European referendum.
But do you believe it?
And I don't, like Michael, I don't think that the Queen usually passes comment like that. And I think that it's a sort of desperate scrabbling of people trying to come up with a reason.
Because if it was true, there would be a generational split since Prince William was supposed to be in favour of staying in.
Yes, yes.
Going to that speech.
Well, that does happen in families, you know.
It does indeed, particularly extended families. The governor of the Bank of England, was he not entirely within his rights? He's asked as to what the biggest domestic uncertainty would be to the British economy, and he says it would be if we left the EU. It doesn't mean it would be wrong to do so, but and that in the medium to long term, everything could work out fine. But there would be uncertainty and risk in the short term, would there not?
There's uncertainty now, obviously. No, it's a big factor. No, I wouldn't attack Mark Carney on this. I think what happened, if you remember, at the global summit in China, where suddenly it appeared in the minutes that all these global leaders who have much more important things to think about thought that Brexit was one of the great uncertainties for the economic future. I think that smelt badly of interference by the Chancellor of the Exchequer. But I think you're right that Mark Carney must admit that there is uncertainty over this. I mean, you know, the uncertainty is that we may move into a bright new future of independence.
How is the referendum playing so far in outside London, outside Westminster?
Well, I've had 10 emails about the EU and I had 400 about bees. Now,
about bees?
About bees. Bees are, so far in my constituency, far more popular. I mean, I suppose much of that comes from the fact that there was a bee vote in the House of Commons and everybody has an equal vote on this, so they don't need to lobby me, they get their own say. But it's not coming up on the doorsteps. People don't volunteer whether they're in or out to me. People very rarely ask me questions about it. I've had very few, I've had far more emails about housing. I've had far more emails about...
If you're right, it raises a very interesting point, which is, you know, what is the turnout going to be in this referendum? And I say that's an interesting point because I think, you know, it's going to be quite difficult for opinion pollsters to gauge this one. I think partly because I think there is a difference between metropolitan opinion, because I think it is quite a hot topic in London, and non-metropolitan opinion. So, you know, if we firstly don't know what people are thinking, and secondly, we don't know which sort of people are going to turn out to vote, it's going to be quite difficult to predict.
Well, they don't know, isn't it, at the moment?
At the moment, it would look like a majority of Conservative voters would vote to leave. Mm-hmm. Which means for the Remain to win, you need the Labour Party. Now, is that really going to happen? Will this Labour vote be mobilised?
I think that we need to do an awful lot to make it seem as if it's a Labour issue, and that it's got Labour at its heart.
But are you going
solidarity.
To do that?
Well, I am. I'm going to try my hardest. And when we're out door knocking, which we do every week still, we ask people the question. I think that, yeah, we have to. It's difficult when you have to campaign all together. But I think that the public is better than that. I don't think they want to see us squabbling about it, actually. They want to see us talking about it together.
Of course, it's not only Labour support that would be needed. It's also Scottish Nationalist
Indeed.
Support.
Mm.
So it is a very interesting referendum, because we're going to see, presumably, the Scottish Nationalists and the Labour Party out there fighting with determination to make sure that David Cameron keeps his job.
I know it's a difficult one to sell, isn't it, to some activists? And it's women. Apparently, we're going to swing it as well. We're always swinging everything, women.
Well,
it's always
the
women's
vote.
We're told
that more women are as yet undecided.
Yeah, apparently so.
And it's been quite a male-dominated campaign so far.
I think that's probably one of the reasons. It seems quite a lot of sort of shirts talking about figures, as we saw in the VT there with Mark Carney and Jacob.
But you're a leading member of the Labour for Cameron movement, aren't you?
I wouldn't say
stop.
I was anything for Cameron.
Stop teasing. Teasing.
I want rid of
don't
him.
Don't rise to the bait. The backdrop, of course, is important. And for those who wish to remain, the backdrop is not encouraging. This deal which Mrs. Merkel is trying to do, and it is Mrs. Merkel trying to do it with the Turks, when you look at it, it almost smacks of desperation.
Well, firstly, doing a deal with the present Turkish government, which is rapidly extinguishing any vestige of a free press, is becoming extremely totalitarian and unpleasant in all sorts of ways. But also, I mean, just the detail of the deal. For every refugee who is deported, and we wonder about the legality of that, from Greece to Turkey.
For every Syrian refugee.
For every Syrian refugee, forgive me. One will then be exported to the European Union, presumably on a plane rather than over land. So, you know, if this thing gets traction, that is a very large number of Syrian refugees who are going to be settled in the European Union. Now, we know what the reaction was before from many European Union countries to Mrs. Merkel's last proposal, which was enacted, which was that Germany should take a very large number, was it 800,000
yes.
Refugees? Well, there will also be a reaction to all of this. And people in Britain will want to know exactly what is their role in this large number, presumably, of Syrian refugees who are going to be directly settled in European Union countries other than Greece.
When we last had the referendum to stay in 1975, the backdrop was one of British huge economic difficulties and a really successful, growing, prosperous European community, as it was then called. That will not be the backdrop this time.
No, that is not the backdrop at this time. And I think that, I suppose, one of the reasons that I feel we should stay is partly because of solidarity and to try and keep things working.
But you say solidarity, we're not going to allow a visa-free entry for Turks. That's just for the Schengen area.
I know, and
is that right?
I think we need to take more refugees, especially refugee children. I have repeatedly said that I think that we are not necessarily doing our bit and we could do more with regard to unaccompanied refugee children. There's thousands
How
of kids
do
going
you,
missing.
In a democracy slavery. With a free press, how do you forcibly remove thousands of migrants on these Greek islands?
Well, what are we going to do? Push them back in the
That's
sea?
That's my question. And how do you do that?
I think the legality of it is questionable, very questionable.
And the practicality.
And the optics of it. I mean, the television cameras are going to be there as the people are, whatever, loaded onto buses and taken to ships or taken to planes. Fearful stuff.
Sunday trading, which England will not have liberalised now, thanks to the Scottish Nationalists and some Tory rebels too. Whatever
Lots
happened to English
rebels.
Votes for English laws, which the Tories had meant to promise?
It's a non-event. And despite this provocation by the Scottish Nationalists in voting down this thing, which really only has effect in England, I don't think we're hearing a lot from the government about English votes for English laws either. I owe to you the insight that this was put in a United Kingdom bill rather than being put
exactly.
into an English and Welsh bill.
The Enterprise Bill.
Which would have made it, I suppose, more difficult anyway. Well, sorry, it would have made it very difficult for the Scottish Nationalists to vote against that. But it is interesting. And I suppose the government is now quite worried about further provocation of the Scots. Everything is on hold, isn't it? I mean, in the film, there was the reference to the dropping of the pension reform. You know, I think George Osborne would like to go down in history as the Chancellor who reformed pensions. But no, because of the referendum, I assume that can't be done. Now we can't, you know, we can't have a Barney with the Scottish Nationalists over Sunday trading because we're worried about the referendum.
Okay. We're not on hold, though, so we'll carry on.